presentation, we will discuss the International Space Station. And we will focus really on the station as a vehicle. We will not be discussing the amazing international cooperation that has made the station possible. And also, we will not really focus on the science and the technology demonstrators that are implemented every day on the ISS. What we want to do is to make justice of this amazing engineering feat. We want to see the extent and the complexity of this vehicle and look a little bit at some of the details on the ISS. We will start by covering some basic facts. Now, the ISS is obviously a human outpost in space. Specifically, it is the only permanently inhabited human outpost in that area of space that we call low Earth orbit. Now, one of the first questions is how big the station is. Well, it is the largest object that humankind has ever flown to space. And if you're talking numbers, when we measure the station from its aftmost compartment, in this picture, it is the automated transfer vehicle, and we go all the way to the forwardmost compartment. And again, in this picture, you have the US space shuttle. You would get about 70 meters, and this is what we would consider the length of the ISS. Likewise, if we measure the width of the station from one end to the other of the integrated truss assembly, we would get around 100 meters. So what that means is that we could actually just barely fit the ISS into one football field, which is not very much in terrestrial terms, but is quite considerable for a space vehicle. As a matter of fact, it took more than 100 launches of several different vehicles from different nations to assemble and outfit the ISS in the form and shape that we know right now. Now, the station is not just a very large vehicle, it is also very massive. With 450 metric tons, it is also the most massive object that has ever been flown to space. And to give some perspective, to give some context, the second most massive object that was ever flown was the Mir space station. And Mir was around 120 tons, which means that the station, the ISS, is around 3.5 times as massive. Now, to give even more context, we could compare the station to something that is more part of our everyday experience. And if we compare it, for instance, with a car, then the mass of the ISS would coincide roughly to 320 cars. And we can go a little bit further and see that actually the station itself with these 450 tons corresponds to the mass of actually the heaviest version of the Boeing 747. And the comparison between the ISS and the 747 is very interesting because we have similarities not just in mass, but also in pressurized volume. So it happens that the ISS has exactly the same pressurized volume of a 747. All right, we have covered how big the station is and how large is its mass. But where exactly does it fly? Low Earth orbit is a relatively large swath of outer space. And we could have actually objects all the way to 1,000 kilometers above the surface and still call them in low Earth orbit. Now, the ISS is a lot closer than that. It flies on a roughly circular orbit at an altitude of 400 kilometers above the surface of the planet, which means if you look at the equations of orbital mechanics that it has to move at an orbital speed of 7.5 kilometers per second. And what that means is that the ISS can revolve around the planet in just 90 minutes. And for the more poetically inclined, one could say that this corresponds to the astronauts onboard the ISS witnessing over the course of 24 hours around 15 sunrises and 15 sunsets. Now, what is also interesting is that, in principle, since there is no atmosphere, the ISS could fly in almost any attitude, in any configuration. Now, the attitude of the station largely depends on what is happening on the station. It depends on whether or not there is a vehicle approaching or what kind of specific activities and situations are being executed. But most of the time, the station has its longitudinal axis pointing in the direction of motion and has one side that is always directed towards the surface of the planet. Now, one important feature of the station's orbit is the inclination. And here there are some interesting facts that are not really known by everyone. The station has an orbit with an inclination of 51.6 degrees. And this number is a little bit strange because in orbital mechanics and in astronautics, one normally would try to launch an object at the same, at an inclination that corresponds to the latitude of the launch site. And most of the station's elements were actually brought to space with the space shuttle, which launched from the Kennedy Space Center in Florida at a latitude of around 28 degrees. So ideally, if we were only focusing on the shuttle, we would say, well, we could get the station at an inclination of around 28 degrees. Now, of course, the station wasn't just assembled using American vehicles. It was also assembled, especially in the early stages, using Russian rockets. And Russian rockets are launched from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan, which is at a latitude of around 45 degrees north. So we could say, okay, maybe to satisfy the requirements of both the space shuttle and the Proton rocket and the Soyuz rocket, we could have the station at an inclination of 45 degrees. Well, that is not the case. The station flies at 51.6, and the reason for that is actually very interesting. If we look at this map, we realize that if the station, or for that matter, any rocket launching from Baikonur was launched at an inclination of 45, 46 degrees, then the rocket, during its powered flight, would fly over China. And what would that mean? Is that there would be pieces of the rocket falling in Chinese territory, which especially in the early days of space exploration in the 60s and in the 70s wasn't something that was really an option. So one has to adapt, and so it happens that 51.6 degrees is the orbital inclination, is the minimal orbital inclination that ensures that the rocket, during its powered flight, always flies over Russian territory. Now, 51.6 degrees is actually not a bad choice for orbital inclination. What is important about this parameter is that it defines the highest altitude, the highest latitude north and the lowest latitude south that are covered by the ground track of the vehicle. And with 51.6 degrees, as we can see from this picture, the station can cover that part of the planet where around 90% of the human population resides, which has some interesting implications, for instance, in terms of the Earth observation activities that can be done from the ISS. One interesting question is, of course, how does the station communicate with mission control? Now, in the early days of space exploration, in programs like Mercury and Gemini, there wasn't really much of a choice. Space agencies had to cover the planet with ground stations, and the vehicles could only communicate with mission control when they were flying over those ground stations. So we see here, for instance, the configuration of different ground stations that were available during the Mercury program. And what is immediately evident from this picture is that there was a lot of them. And actually some were not even on the solid ground. To optimize coverage, a few antennas were mounted on ships that were moved so that the coverage and the time the astronauts could communicate with the flight control team on ground could be maximized. Now, this is very expensive and it requires a lot of logistics, which is the reason why over the years a different communication system was devised, and that is what is currently used for the International Space Station. The system is called the Tracking and Data Relay Satellite System, and it is composed of two parts. There is a flight segment with a constellation of telecommunication satellites in geostationary orbit, and there is a ground segment, which is composed of two main antennas. One is at White Sands in New Mexico, the other one is on the island of Guam. So if, for instance, one of the astronauts on board wants to call mission control, they would take the microphone and the signal would be routed from the antennas on the ISS all the way to one of the satellites in geostationary orbit. And from there, it would be relayed back to either White Sands or to the antenna on the island of Guam. And of course, from those ground stations, the signal would be relayed to mission control and of course, back to convey the answer. This is a system that ensures, in theory, uninterrupted coverage. In theory, mission control can talk to the astronauts on board the ISS at any point in time during the day. Now, of course, TDRS is a shared system and the ISS is not the only user. So normally we only use a few of the satellites available and only for a limited amount of time. Of course, there are situations like vehicle dockings or EVAs or important operations involving the robotic arm where we want to know what is happening on board at each and every point in time. And when we are in one of those situations, we enter what is called TDRS critical. And what that means is that we would claim more resources than normal, and we would use those resources to keep an eye on what is happening on board all day long or for as long as it is necessary.